The hospital, Rigshospitalet, was founded in 1757 by King Frederick V as the Royal King Frederick's Hospital. It was the first hospital in the Nordic Scandinavian countries where the aim was to cure patients and to do research. That is the leading research hospital in this area of the world.
At our department, we have over the last 15 years built a comprehensive platform that enables us to take PET tracers and radionuclide therapies, theranostics, all the way from idea and into first in humans. And we strongly believe at our department that what we develop will become enablers for practicing personalized medicine. We are particularly focused on making new technologies and developing new tracers and theranostics that will make a true difference for cancer patients in the future. One example of a tracer that we have taken first in humans is copper-64 dotatate. That is a PET tracer for neuroendocrine tumors.
For us, the introduction of copper-64 dotatate has resulted in major logistic improvement compared to the use of gallium-68 labeled tracer. We no longer depend on synthesis for 1 to 2 patients, but instead we now receive a batch for up to 12 patients that lasts all day. On top of this, a better image quality due to the copper-64 labeled tracer is an additional bonus.
Over the last years, we have taken several PET tracers first in human, all the way from idea into first in humans and then into benefiting patients. As an example, I could mention uPAR. uPAR is a marker of aggressiveness, and uPAR-PET, which we develop, may therefore be used for diagnosing, for risk stratification, as a companion diagnostic, and finally, if labeled, with alpha or beta emitters as radionuclide therapy. Until now, we have scanned more than 300 patients successfully with the uPAR-PET tracers, and we expect much of this in the future. At our state-of-the-art radiochemistry facility, where we have many hot cells, laboratories, and 2 cyclotrons, we can produce our experimental tracers from our development program, but we can also take them all the way into patients as we can produce them fully GMP compliant.
In this facility, we can synthesize and radiolabel new radio tracers as well as therapeutic nuclear ligands from our development pipeline. In case of uPAR, as a part of the development, we have radiolabeled the ligands with gallium-68, fluorine-18 and copper-64 for imaging and lutetium-177 for therapy.
We have currently 16 tracers which we have permission to use in humans. And during the last 10 years, we've developed several novel PET tracers which have been taken all the way from preclinical testing to first-in-human studies.
Following the development and in vitro testing of our new compounds for PET tracers or for radionuclide therapy, we then take them into animal testings. And here we have built a comprehensive platform where we have all the equipment necessary, PET, SPECT, MRI and CT. We also focus within cancer, particularly on having very relevant animal models. This includes using patient-derived xenograft models called PDX and even implanting them autotopically. So if we are testing a new imaging ligand or therapeutic ligand, we do that in a brain cancer. We do that in a human brain cancer implanted into a mouse brain. We then take the most promising ligands into first in humans. And these studies are performed as clinical trials that are fully GCP compliant.
At our department, we have tested the uPAR-PET probe to visualize the tumors. So far, the pictures have looked very good, and we have found a spatial correlation between the biopsy and the images with the uPAR. It's also very important if we can have the uPAR-PET attached to an optic probe and thereby visualize the tumor live during surgery and the borders of the tumor. I'm also excited about the uPAR-targeted radionuclide therapy in the future. The PET images indicate high uptake can be expected.
At our department, we have for many years performed radionuclide therapy, both with beta emitters and with alpha emitters. But increasingly we use our unit for that also to make clinical trials on new radionuclide therapies. We are currently moving heavily into immune imaging, tracking immune cells. This will find an important application within immune oncology, but also in other diseases where inflammation is a major part of the pathophysiology, like in atherosclerosis and in arthritis.
One of the major challenges in personalized medicine within cancer treatment is the availability of non-invasive tools as companion diagnostics. I personally look forward to the tools currently being developed at the Department of Nuclear Medicine for monitoring the immune system and how it may be used in tailoring immunotherapy within cancer. Also, new PET tracers for therapy targets such as tissue factor may become valuable in the future to enable the practice of personalized medicine.
In the future, we will see more practicing of personalized or precision medicine. And I truly believe that nuclear medicine, both with its imaging and its therapeutic part, will become an enabler for making this come true, as we can select the right therapy for the right patient at the right time.